Welcome back, friends. Now let's see our discussion on HDFS, and this is the continuation of our previous discussions on HDFS write anatomy. And in write anatomy, we have seen the network distance as well as the how replication has been done while writing into the system and so on. So now in this particular session, we just try to see how exactly the coherence model works here. So coherence model for a file system describes the data visibility of reads and writes for a file. So what exactly is this visibility? Now whenever we are trying to make reading and writing into any of the hardware, then automatically we can see that there is some latency being given in reading or writing, because we have to search the complete data storage. So there we may require some time to make sure that the data has been written perfectly. For example, when we are trying to copy anything into our hard disk also, we see that a lot of time is consumed for making that. But when we are trying to save any of the data into the HDFS, then how exactly this has to function is mentioned inside the coherency model. So HDFS has some trade-offs with the portable operating system interface in Unix requirements for performance. So POSIX is nothing but portable operating system interface in Unix or any other operating system. So just to say that any operating system will have some trade-off, or I can say will have to make a compromise on working with the writing operation or the reading operation present inside the hard disk. So how we are trying to deal with these things when we are working with the HDFS is nothing but coherency model. So after creating a file, it is visible in the file system namespace as expected, but the problem is any content written to the file is not guaranteed to be visible even if the stream is flushed. So the file appears to have the length of zero. How exactly this happens? Because most of the times we see that we just submit the things, and after submit we feel that the file has been stored, and in case of big data analytics we see that the data files are very very huge, and it takes at least some of the time for uploading your complete file. So the thing is, whenever we see that open that file again, then there may be a lot of chances that we may find our file which is of zero data content. So how exactly this happens when we are working with the writing inside our programs? So we are just giving the path here, and we are using fs.create, which creates a new file for inside this path, and we assert that fs.exist is true. Then what we do is outstream out fs.createp, and we write the contents into the output stream of our file, and we just make use of the flush function so that all the data, whatever I am writing to the HDFS using the output stream, will be written inside the file in the HDFS. But after making use of this flush, if I just use the status of this particular file and get the length of the file, then we have to check it whether it is zero length. So there are 90% chances that we will be getting zero length because of the latency present inside the HDFS. So for this, what we do is we make use of some other function called as sync. So along with the flush function, we make use of one more function called as sync, where the data nodes will be making use of some buffers through which the data will be synchronized to our FS data output stream. So by making use of this sync, we can get the proper data length of our file present inside the HDFS. So sync must be used always whenever we are trying to store anything inside the HDFS file system. So that is with respect to coherency model. Now let us see how we are trying to work with the parallel copying with the dist CP. So why we need the parallel copying? So we see that there is a lot of replication present inside the HDFS whenever we are trying to write the data into the HDFS file system. So when we are trying to make use of this, then copying one system at a time takes a lot of time. So it is better to make use of parallel copying for multiple replicas inside the HDFS clusters. So whenever there is a data transferring between two HDFS clusters, then we can go for distcp command, and using this distcp command we can make use of this file replication a lot more faster than the conventional one. So there are if the clusters are running identical versions of Hadoop, the HDFS scheme is something like this. The HDFS scheme is appropriate. We can use Hadoop command and with the distcp, and this is the file name. Inside the name node 1 and name node 2, then the name node 1 will be copied to name node 2 in the form of bar. So similarly, we can also update the things by using hyphen update function with the distcp. So this is for copying the file same to same, and the second command is for updation of the file, right? So here the file name is foo, and here the second file name, the second path is bar. So inside the bar folder we are trying to copy the foo. So similarly here also, we inside the inside the foo file or folder, we are trying to update the contents. So similarly, an HDFS cluster must be balanced. So the first replica of each block would reside on the node running the map until the disk is filled up. So most of the times we see that this is the case whenever we are trying to copy anything into our files. But when data is being written into our hard disk, we see that wherever there is a free space, our operating system will decide where exactly I have to place the things, and wherever there is a free space, on the first come first serve basis, it just makes sure that the free space is used by that particular writing operation. But in case of HDFS, there are many clusters. So suppose if I have a data storage in let me call myself as name node 1 or data node 1, and I am trying to store the data, and I have a lot of space with me. So there is a convention that every time HDFS needs more and more replicas. So when I need more and more replicas, then the data whatever I want to store, if I have a free space within my system, then the operating system is having the tendency to go on making use of that free space and storing the replicas inside the same PC or inside the same computer, which is not correct at all. So for that reason, we have to see that a HDFS cluster gets an equal amount of nodes so that the clusters are balanced every time. So for this reason, most of the times the distcp is used with the default of 20 maps per node. So that is 20 maps will be written every time whenever we are writing the nodes. So for this reason, it is best to start by running this one distcp with the 20 maps, that is 20 parallel systems will be used to write the HDFS clusters data. Okay, next is Hadoop archives. This is something like a jar file where we use Java archive file. So something like this, when we are trying to work with the archive file of Hadoop, it is called as Hadoop archive file. So we can reduce the name node memory usage while still allowing the transparent access to the files. So how we can access those Hadoop archives is, in order to list the things, I just use file system command Hadoop fs file system minus lsr, which will list all the files. So this is the list of the files whatever we have. Then similarly, we can have the archive name files.jar. So what are the files present inside that particular folder called as my. So we can get the folders after my. This is the archive command. So archive command in order to make all these files into one. So after making use of that archive command, if I want to see what is there inside that, then I will see my. Then I will see that there is my files and files.hr, which is a archive file. So this is how I'll be. The first statement is for checking the files. So I have a file called as my slash files slash a, then dir, then dir slash b. So these are the files, and by using this archive command, I am trying to make use of all these files into one archive file called as files.har. This is used for checking whether archive file has been created. So to see what are there inside the archive file, what I do is minus ls with give the files.har. Then I will be listing all the things present inside that. But along with that, we will be having some more extra part, something called as my that is index and master index, to show what exactly the files are having the parts. So here list the files and directories inside the .har. So here we can see that it is just listing, and if I want to see the contents present inside the file recursively, then we go for minus lsr har, that is, and give, this is nothing but the path I am using, minus lsr, which will go for recursively seeing what is there inside that archive file. Then the commands like minus lsr and minus lsr, these two things are having the same impact. We can see that we are using a HAR colon slash slash, and here we are using HDFS localhost and so on. So both of things are one and the same. So if I want to remove any of the archive file, then I will just use minus RMR, which stands for remove the archive file. So we can remove it from the directory. Then what is the limitation? The limitation is to be aware of the archive files is it creates a copy of the original file, so we need much disk space as the files you are archiving to create the archive, because the problem is it will be the combination of all the files in the raw format, so we need a lot of space. Then archive files can be used to as input to the MapReduce function, and archive files are immutable once they have been created. That is, we cannot make the changes to that archive file if it is being created. So to add or remove files, we need to recreate the archive again and again. So however, the archive aware input format that can pack multiple files into a single MapReduce split, so processing lots of small files even in our archive file will be inefficient. So for that reason, archive files are of most of the times avoided. So it is just to take the backup. For taking the backup, archive file is okay, but when you are trying to work with that archive file, then it is inefficient. So it is advisable that not make use of archive files whenever there is a need of processing. If I want to take the backup of that particular HDFS file system, then we can make use of the archive file. So this is about HDFS. So if there are anything to be covered, we will see in the subsequent lectures. Thank you.